Welcome to the Heal Your Hunger Show, where we get to the heart of why you overeat and how to stop. If you struggle with food and weight like I did, welcome home. Welcome, everybody, to the Heal Your Hunger Show. So happy to have you here. It is a great day to be alive, and Happy New Year. Yes, indeed. Let's do it differently this year. What about it? So I'm certainly looking forward to 2021. We now know anything can happen, but let's all collectively put our good juju behind just a fantastic, wonderful year of hope and recovery and healing and prosperity and productivity and just abundance of every kind. How does that sound? So at the Heal Your Hunger Show, if you're here for the first time, first of all, welcome. What we do is we focus on the underlying causes of emotional eating because it's really not about the food. So if you're so sick and tired of being sick and tired of dieting and exercising away binges, late night binges, guess what? There is a different way. There is a better way. You don't have to struggle anymore. You don't have to fight food. My friend Roy Nelson used to say, you know, fighting food is like squaring off with a Russian tank using only an archery set. Like you're going to get flattened, you know, and we can't go toe to toe with food. What we have to do is have like some stealth measures. And that is by going deeper and dealing with the underlying causes and having new ways of coping with life and the stress of life besides turning to carbs and sugar. So that's what we do here is we explore those different ways here at the Heal Your Hunger Show. And often I have amazing guests come and join me to talk about different health issues that pertain to the life of the emotional eater. You know, as women, we have a lot of things going on in our bodies, especially if maybe we haven't been treating our bodies so well. So I want to make sure you get just absolute top-notch information about how to be healthy in the most natural way possible, okay? Because we don't want to junk up our bodies with more chemicals or things that have adverse side effects. So yeah, today's going to be one of those shows. I have an amazing guest today. And also, if you haven't joined us in the Secret Sauce group, that's where I interview a lot of my guests and you can hear it live, hot off the press. So go to Facebook and type in the Secret Sauce to End Emotional Eating Now and join us for the conversation. You can comment, you know, we can have a conversation. You could also learn about things that are happening with Heal Your Hunger and get the support you need to end emotional eating. You can't do it on your own. Don't try to do it on your own. It's too hard. Food addiction is too big, too powerful, and you got to eat, right? You got to eat. So get the support you need. Join us in the Secret Sauce group. And then lastly, take the quiz if you haven't yet. It's the emotional eating quiz, which will let you know where you are on the emotional eating spectrum. You're either an emotional eater or a food addict or somewhere in between. And when you take this 3-minute quiz, you will get a personalized score. So you know exactly where you are and what steps you need to take in order to heal. So on with the show. Welcome to our guest. Dr. Stephanie Gray is a functional medicine provider who helps men and women build a sustainable and optimal health and longevity so they can focus on what matters most to them. She's an amazingly accomplished woman. She's a nurse practitioner since 2009. She completed her doctorate in focusing on estrogen metabolism from the University of Iowa. And she also has a master's in metabolic nutritional medicine from University of South Florida Medical School. So cool. But I think what's really important, what we're going to focus on today is her strategies for longevity. She is the host of the Your Longevity Blueprint podcast and the co-founder of the Your Longevity Blueprint Nutraceuticals with her husband, Eric, and they also own the Integrative Health and Hormone Clinic in Iowa. And she's the best-selling author of it's Your Longevity Blueprint, right?
Yes, yeah, that's correct.
Yep. All right, there we go. Well, welcome, Stephanie. So glad to have you here.
Thank you for having me on the show.
Yeah, it's great to have you. And I love what you do. And I know you're so busy doing it. So many people want a part of you, you know, hopefully your self-care is in check and you're practicing, you know, as well as you can, administering to other people while taking good care of yourself so you can keep doing it. So let's talk about this. Like, how did you get into, you know, really helping people with longevity?
Yeah. So I think when we think longevity, if we really want to live long, I want to kind of differentiate conventional medicine from functional medicine, because okay. functional medicine, I believe, helps us get at the root cause of our problems and helps us live longer, right? With conventional yeah. medicine, if you have heart disease, you put on a pill, right, for lowering blood pressure or lowering cholesterol. But does that really promote longevity? Depends on who you talk to. Right. Just as many people with low cholesterol have heart attacks as those with high cholesterol. So when we think of longevity, we really want to think about optimizing every single organ system in the body. And using functional medicine is a way, a strategy to do that. So how I got into this was, well, A, my self-care wasn't awesome, that you were kind of alluding to. I had a lot of stress. I'd built a practice and I was in grad school and I just had too much on my plate. And I had my own health catastrophe, as many of us do who get into this world. But I think if we go back to functional medicine for a moment here, again, going back to longevity, what I try to help my patients do is to get to the root cause of their problem, right? So if we think of conventional medicine as being more the fire department, they're here to put out big, bad, ugly fires, which can help us live longer if you're having a heart attack. But putting out the fire doesn't always get at the root cause of the fire in the first place. So when we think of functional medicine, I describe functional medicine in my book as being more of a carpenter or a contractor. We try to repair and rebuild the body, just like you would a house, so that you can live longer within that house or within that body. So that's when I think of longevity, I always have to talk about the functional medicine approach that I use with my patients that I've applied to myself as well.
I love that. And that is really perfectly aligned with Heal Your Hunger, because we're all about, you know, ditching the diets and really getting to the root cause of why we're eating in the first place, why we're compelled to go back to the refrigerator time and time again. And when you start dealing with the underlying emotional causes of our, you know, out of control eating, that's when we can really make real changes. So love it. Okay. So let's talk about some of the tenets of longevity. Like, I mean, I know it's kind of obvious in some ways to people nowadays, but I really find that I'm very healthy and yet I really can't hear it enough. So, you know, you might say some things people have heard, but we need to hear it again, because we lapse into automatic pilot, you know, grabbing foods on the go that are processed and not healthy, and, you know, and not getting enough sleep and drinking too much coffee, and, you know, the whole nine yards. So can you just sort of run down, and then I want to get into hormone health, yeah, but yeah. Can you run down sort of some of the major pillars of longevity?
So when I think of longevity, right, there's no pill for that ill, or we have to, again, build a healthy body. So I think I'll take you back to the analogy that I use in my book. So we all know how to maintain our homes. Well, we hope, right? We mow our lawns. we change our furnace filters. We keep hair out of the drains. There are just certain things that we know. I got to change the furnace filters, whatnot. There are things we're doing to maintain that home. And then we don't always think of, like, what can I be doing for my body so that my body is around for a long time? Because we're only given one, right? So I wanted to introduce, because it's just not common knowledge to many individuals, what they can do for every single organ system in their body through this longevity blueprint concept. So like through my book, the most important piece of longevity is gastrointestinal health, which many people wouldn't tie to longevity, but right. I do. And if we compare that to the home, because that's what I'm doing through my book, I'm comparing right up a portion of our home to an organ system in the body. We think back to that home, the foundation of that home has to support the weight of the entire house, or the house is going to crumble, right? Have to have a strong foundation upon which to build that house. And you need a strong gastrointestinal foundation upon which to build good health. So back to clean eating again, reducing inflammation in the body, avoiding your food sensitivities, treating gut infections.
Slow. You talk very fast. You got to slow this train down. So let's do each one of those. Those are so important.
So two pieces of building good gut health are removing food sensitivities.
Okay, food sensitivities.
So basically foods that are causing inflammation, which can vary person to person, but for many people, gluten, dairy, soy, right? Those can be inflammatory. Sometimes eggs, usually always sugar. Yeah. Those can cause problems and wreak havoc on our body and alter our neurotransmitter production, right? Like serotonin, dopamine, epinephrine, norepinephrine.
Those things that help us feel good.
Right, right. The other piece that's many times neglected, another piece of gut health, is treating gut infections. Okay. So here we're thinking about things like yeast overgrowth, or parasites, right? If you have a beast inside you, you're going to have sugar cravings. You're going to essentially want to feed that beast. And so for many patients, I have to treat them for yeast, which mm-hmm. does get rid of sugar cravings and whatnot. And many of us, due to insult from antibiotic use or acne,
right,
or urinary tract infections, whatnot, or bacterial vaginosis, whatnot, patients have used antibiotics for, which impacts the microbiome and feeds opportunistic yeast. And so for many of my patients, step one is removing inflammatory foods. Step two is removing inflammatory bugs, treating the gut infections.
Got it. Yes. So, so important. And obviously in your work with patients, this is what you test for, is to see what's going on.
Exactly. And that's the strength of functional medicine. Rather than guess, we can test to see how we need to make those changes.
Test, not guess. I love that. Okay. So really important. I love the gut health aspect. I think that is overlooked for longevity. What are some other pillars of longevity?
So I also think correcting nutritional deficiencies, that's kind of pillar four, step four, is really important because our food sources are not as nutritionally dense as they used to be, right? The magnesium count in nuts or in broccoli is not what it used to be. And so many of my patients think they don't need the supplement, but I find different when we test them. So we can look, plus, gosh, this year of all years where many people are stressed out, stress depletes magnesium. If you drink coffee, if you exercise, you're depleting your body of really important magnesium. And so many individuals have no idea that they are so nutritionally deficient. So therefore, testing and then supplementing accordingly can be very helpful from a longevity standpoint. All of our organ systems need nutrients to function. So if we're low on those, then we're headed for problems.
Got it. Any other pillars you want to talk about?
Well, the hormone pillar is my favorite.
All right. Good segue.
So in chapter six, I'm comparing the heating and cooling system of the home, right? Because you want to have a comfortable temperature in your home, to essentially the heating and cooling system of your body, the endocrine system. So we think the adrenal glands, the thyroids, and hormones, which can influence our appetite, our hunger, right? They can also influence weight, whatnot. So that would be the most fun pillar for me, because with my patients, when I can optimize their hormones, they tend to feel better much more quickly. And if they start feeling better, then they're motivated to make better lifestyle changes. So I like optimizing hormones. That's my favorite pillar.
Okay. I love that. How does one know if they have hormone imbalances?
Yeah, I think there are two major ways. So one is testing, of course. So blood, saliva, or urine testing. And many times you have to find a functional medicine provider who can test you. Because too many of my patients go to their providers and they ask their provider to test their hormone levels, but the provider says, oh, there's no need to test, you're fine. Or if they test from a very basic standpoint, they really don't dive in deep. So you want to make sure you find a provider who can comprehensively test your hormone levels. And then secondly, I pair the levels with symptoms. So I have a symptom questionnaire that my patients will work through. So many times they may not know that fatigue or hot flashes are sometimes an obvious symptom of hormone imbalances, but sometimes anxiety or depression aren't always symptoms. Patients don't always assume that those are potentially a hormone imbalance. And especially in that perimenopausal age range.
Yep,
they certainly can be.
Okay. So, since it's my show, we're going to talk about perimenopause for a second. Cause that's where I am. And I don't have symptoms really, by the grace of God. I still have a regular period and I'm healthy, as I said, so I don't have any strange things happening. And I don't plan on it, actually, just FYI, just going to put it out there, not planning on having any symptoms. But what are some typical symptoms that women will start to have?
So the first hormone that I say to go is usually progesterone. So progesterone is the most soothing, calming hormone. It's great for sleep and anxiety, regulating cycles, keeping them not heavy. And so when I start to see women, even in their 30s or early 40s, come in feeling tightly wound, irritable, moody, with heavier periods, maybe starting to become a little irregular. They feel like they need an anxiety medication or sleeping pill. That to me cues me in, oh, we better look at progesterone levels. So that's usually the first hormone that starts declining. And stress will rob you of that progesterone too. Second hormone that I see go is testosterone. And sometimes women don't think they need testosterone, but we do. We really do need testosterone. Right. So testosterone helps with mood, motivation, drive, libido, and energy. So a lot of women will feel like, gosh, I'm losing my muscle mass. I'm still going to the gym, but I don't have that muscle gain, or my recovery is poor. I just kind of feel blah, like I just don't have that motivation I used to have. And then estrogen symptoms, by the time those set in, low estrogen symptoms, I should say, many women are kind of miserable. If they're having hot flashes, night sweats that impact their sleep, vaginal dryness, memory fog, whatnot, those are probably the most common low estrogen symptoms, but sometimes you can't tell you have symptoms. Like you may be able to tell your memory is declining, as far as if you you walk into a room and you forget, wait, why did I walk into this room? What was I going to do? But that could be a low estrogen symptom. But even dementia, right? Like significant cognitive decline can be from low hormone levels. And that it sometimes can be difficult to gauge until it gets pretty bad. Bone loss, that's difficult to gauge. You may not have symptoms of bone loss unless you have a fracture, until you get a bone density scan. And then, I've had some bone loss, which can be related to hormone decline.
Wow. Okay. That's a really wide range of symptoms. That's incredible. And so, are we doing like natural supplements to help with this stuff?
Yeah. So I try to just honor whatever my patients' goals are. So some patients come to me and they say, I don't want to take hormones. What do you have for me? I need to get rid of these hot flashes. What can I take? So we can test for nutritional deficiencies. We can help patients detox the body. We can coach them on stress reduction, all things to help them boost their hormones naturally. We can use supplements, or we can use hormone replacement therapy in certain cases. So I will say fish oil is wonderful for so many things, including hot flashes. So sometimes I'll use fish oil on my patients. Sometimes I'll use herbs. If we can test and we determine that progesterone or testosterone or estrogen is low, we can use herbs to boost those hormones specifically. Some patients have had hysterectomies. Herbs aren't going to help those patients, right? If they don't have ovaries, that the herbs help. There are going to be select cases of women who need natural hormone replacement therapy.
So there's natural hormone replacement therapy. That means they're taking a cream, like a progesterone cream or some other types of, talk to me about what natural hormone replacement sounds like or is.
Yeah. So when many women hear hormones, they think cancer. They think, I don't want to take hormones because my mom had breast cancer and she took Premarin, or maybe her mother took synthetic hormones. So there's a big difference between synthetic and natural hormones. So synthetic hormones are usually there. So Premarin was one that I mentioned, right? That came from horse urine. Premarin stands for pregnant mare's urine. But those are hormones that I don't use in my patients. That's what was used in the Women's Health Initiative study that scared a lot of patients and providers away from using hormones. So I don't want to replicate what was done in that study. So I don't want to use synthetic hormones. Natural hormones come from a plant-based source, usually yam, sometimes soy, but usually they're yam-based. So the route of application for that can be a topical gel or cream, like you mentioned, can be an oral capsule, can be a sublingual lozenge that women put under their tongue, or they can be implanted. Subcutaneous hormone implants are becoming very popular these days. Yep.
Okay. The
first clinic in Iowa to administer hormone pellets. So we've been doing those a long time. Regardless of what route of administration is selected for the patient, what's most important is that they find a provider who can monitor their labs throughout that therapy. So a lot of patients, if you don't have a practitioner who knows what they're doing, sometimes hormone replacement therapy can get messy. And it's really important that it's effective, but also safe and not messy for that patient.
And is natural hormone replacement therapy the same as bioidentical hormone replacement therapy?
Yes. And so what that means is that hormone is biologically identical to what hormone your body's supposed to be making. Right. Okay. So when we think of because this is such an important concept, In my book, I actually had someone draw out the molecular structure of synthetic hormones like birth control and natural hormones, and then what your body makes. So you can compare and see, okay, if we think of hormones fitting like a key in a keyhole, right, your hormone has to fit in a hormone receptor. If you're taking a synthetic hormone, that key looks a little different. That key is not going to fit into that lock appropriately or into your hormone receptor appropriately. So it's really important that patients understand synthetics are not the best option for them. And synthetics come with risks that naturals don't.
Got it. Oh, great to know. And then if somebody's had a hysterectomy, do they need hormone replacement?
So that depends. So I've had some women sail through their hysterectomy just fine. Sometimes they do fine short-term. Sometimes it depends on if the ovaries are left or not, right? Even if the ovaries are left, the blood supply to the ovaries has been cut off. So research shows ovaries last a few years, right? So if you had a hysterectomy in your 30s or 40s, I don't know if you're going to get by without hormone replacement therapy another 10, 20 years. It just, there's so many variables that go into that answer. But if patients are symptomatic and they have low hormone levels post-hysterectomy, yes. I've tested some women the week before their hysterectomy and the week after because they want to know exactly what happens in that 2-week time period. And the results are dramatic for many cases.
Wow, that's fascinating. Yeah, definitely don't figure that out on your own, right? That's important.
Eating a healthy lifestyle, incorporating lots of healthy fats, right? Your hormones come from cholesterol. So you actually need avocados, seeds, nuts. You need, that's what I had for my little lunch day. Yes. I had some healthy nuts here. Yes, you need that upon which to build hormones. So back to nutritional deficiencies, one of the best things you can do to ensure your goal, like sailing through perimenopause, is to eat, I don't know what the correct word is, eat a sensible diet with jam-packed with nutrient-dense foods so that you're not nutritionally deficient. So your body can make those hormones so you can sail through.
Love that. And what are your top three tips and nutrients to help with estrogen metabolism?
So estrogen metabolism. So we should define what that is.
Okay.
if we just think of nutrients for boosting hormones in general, magnesium, selenium, zinc, omegas, right? Those are all important. But if we want to talk about estrogen metabolism, that's the means by which our body detoxifies or eliminates estrogen. So we're exposed to estrogen in the environment through plastics, through fragrances. I'm in Iowa, so herbicides and pesticides, right? I inhale if I roll my window down driving home from work. Right. So when we're exposed to those sort of, we'll say nasty chemicals, right? They can bind to our estrogen receptor. Even if you're not taking hormone replacement therapy, that can raise your estrogen levels. And then, unfortunately, if our liver can't handle that, we can pack on the pounds, which is not good. But that can increase our risk for fibroid cysts, breast cancers, whatnot. So I want to make sure, especially if I'm prescribing my patients hormones, that their liver can handle the estrogen I'm giving them and the estrogen they're exposed to in the environment. So the best supplements or nutrients for that are firstly cruciferous vegetables, broccoli, cauliflower,
Brussels sprouts.
Yes, kale, Brussels sprouts. Believe it or not, they're really easy to cook. Just literally salt and olive oil and salt is what I use.
Oh my God. I made the best, just to do a little squirrel here. I made the best Brussels sprouts the other day because I bought them. The local grocery store had a bunch of them cut, like already the top leaves were off, cut in half. I'm like, this is my kind of Brussels sprout that I don't have to do any work. I mixed them up with olive oil and salt and pepper and mm-hmm. put them in a pan and just roasted the hell out of them. And they were so good.
And you can do that for cauliflower. Just cut it up. We do that for our son all the time for dinner. So those cruciferous vegetables help with phase 1 estrogen metabolism. Every week you should be buying ahead of something, broccoli, cauliflower, Brussels sprout. You should be buying something like that every weekend and going through that. And I also tell my patients fish. And we don't have a coastal diet here in Iowa, so also eat fish, but not that that influences estrogen metabolism, but just something I advise my patients on. Now for phase 2 estrogen metabolism, B vitamins are really important. A lot of drugs deplete B vitamins, stress depletes B vitamins. So for many of my patients who I'm also confirming need for through testing, I'm recommending B complex, a methylated B complex for them. And then some patients also need antioxidants for help with estrogen metabolism. So those are kind of the top three things to help reduce breast cancer risk. But even if you don't have breast cancer, if you've had fibroids, cysts, whatnot, your estrogen metabolism, your liver clearance of estrogen is probably not optimal. So DIM, which is an extract from cruciferous vegetables or the vegetables themselves, B vitamins and antioxidants can be very helpful, which promote longevity. Back to our kind of topic today.
Great. I love it. And then I also just want to underscore what you said about just environmental toxicity as well and how important it is to, be mindful of that and to work on that.
Yeah, so I was just taking a drink out of my Yeti here, right? So you want to make sure you're drinking out of stainless steel or glass, not which you were drinking out of earlier, I think.
Glass.
Not plastic. So plastic can leach into, well, in any of our containers, not just drinking or beverage containers, but plastic can leach into everything. And having a son now who's almost a few years old, I realized, gosh, plastic is in his toys. It's in the shower curtain. Mm. Once you start really looking, plastic is everywhere. Yeah. So getting rid of plastics and tying this back to hormones also, dairy is also full of a lot of, we'll just say, chemicals that can impact our estrogen also. So when you think of milk comes in a milk carton that's been lined with plastic, right? More plastic, which comes from a cow that's been injected with probably synthetic hormones, right? That eats grains that have been sprayed with herbicides and pesticides that have mold toxins on them, right? So you have layer upon layer upon layer of endocrine disrupting, we'll just say estrogen raising chemicals in dairy. So for many of my patients with hormone imbalances, just getting them off dairy can be very, very helpful. And so I think of dairy as kind of an environmental estrogen, it has layers of environmental estrogens in it. And personal care products are another huge culprit there, specifically fragrances. That's hard for me when patients walk in and, you know, their smell lights up the whole clinic. It's like, whoa, I need to talk to this patient about changing out their perfume for some essential oils. But when I can explain to them that they're here to feel better, right? And this fragrance is impacting their hormones, then they're going to be more motivated to get rid of it, swap for something safer.
It's so hard to imagine. It seems like one has nothing to do with the other, but everything's connected now, basically.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I feel blessed for the knowledge I have, but I went through an infertility battle and I had severe endometriosis. And I think back to what I didn't know and what my parents didn't know, all the chemical hair straighteners that I was getting, all the bath and body work, you know, products I was using, the toxic makeup, all of those things contributed to my endometriosis. I guarantee cheese was my favorite food. So I guarantee that those behaviors that I had contributed to the problem, but I didn't know, and that's okay. I know now, so I can make changes now.
Beautiful. Oh, such important information, and all the more reason why we have to address emotional eating and start being smarter. You know, it's not even a smart, because so many women know, like, they're very intelligent and they know exactly what's good for their body and what isn't, but the emotional eating piece keeps them emotionally tied to foods like dairy, a cheese, a big one. Women love cheese, right? And ice cream and all those things that just wreck our health, our gut, you know, everything, our hormone system. So thanks so much for spelling this all out. It's really wonderful, Stephanie. And I think it's just, again, really important to hear these reminders. I need it. This has been super helpful for me. So thanks so much for sharing this. How do people get a hold of you and talk to us about that?
Yeah. So I have two websites. IHHclinic.com is my clinic in Iowa. It's the Integrative Health and Hormone Clinic. And then my book is Your Longevity Blueprint, which you can find at yourlongevityblueprint.com. You can find the podcast there as well, or on any, podcast apps, whatnot. I also have a free download on that site for 3 tips to boost your hormones naturally, where I talk about the nutritional deficiencies, detoxing the body, and reducing stress. So certainly check that out. And you can follow me on Instagram at Stephanie Gray, DNP.
Love it. And we'll put that stuff, guys, we'll put that in the show notes. So go to healyourhunger.com and just check out the show notes that go along with this podcast episode. So beautiful. And as a last question for you, Stephanie, this is the Heal Your Hunger show. As you know, what is your deepest hunger?
Oh man, I could go so many different ways with this. Right now, I think Tricia, you got me. I don't know how to pick one. How do I pick one?
Stump everybody. You're not the only one.
Yeah.
Yeah. Pick one. We know there's many.
This may sound really silly, but I'm in a point in my life right now where my hunger right now is more time with my son, because I'm never going to get these years back. Everyone keeps telling me between the ages of 2 and 4, so much happens, you know, between their, you know, their firm pitch. So I think my biggest hunger right now is creating margin in my life where I can just enjoy time with my family.
Beautiful. So beautiful. I want that for you. So thank you for sharing that and all the incredible gems that you've shared today on how we can increase our longevity and be happier and healthier. So blessings to you, Stephanie. Thank you so much. And thanks everybody for tuning in. It's always a pleasure having you visit us here at the Heal Your Hunger Show. Please come back for another great episode of the show. And please share with friends and review if you feel like doing something really nice. So go to the podcast and review it, please. We appreciate that. And it'll help more people find us. So thanks again, Stephanie. Really appreciate you.
Thanks for having me on.
Okay.
If you enjoyed this podcast and want to get free support, insider health info, exclusive invites to events, and more, visit healyourhunger.com.